Well, I want to say welcome to everybody today to the workshop, Understanding Nutrition and Parkinson's Disease. We are very happy to have Debbie Polisky come and talk to us and have a fun interactive session on nutrition and on how to help us learn a little bit more about good nutrition in general, but also good nutrition to help with your Parkinson's symptoms. Just a couple of things, housekeeping things I want to go over today. For those of you who aren't aware of how to use the Zoom chat feature for our questions and answer sessions, we will be doing the questions and answers through chat. So for those of you who are on a regular computer, not an Apple, the chat button should be at the bottom of your screen. If you just scroll your mouse over the screen, the chat button should appear. It looks like a little bubble, you know, above the top of your head from the cartoons, and you'll be able to write your questions in there, and then we will get to those throughout the course of the presentation. If for some reason your question is not answered during the presentation or afterwards, we will get you a response to that question offline. The other thing I want to let everybody know is during today's session, we will be doing three poll questions. How that works is when it comes time, you'll actually see a box pop up in the middle of your screen asking you to take a poll. You will just vote and then you'll get to see what everybody else is voting. So don't be alarmed at that, just so you know that's coming. I want to say thank you to our sponsors today. Without these great sponsors, we would not be able to bring you all of these great programs we're able to do today. Our sponsors include AbbVie, Acadia, Acorda, Boston Scientific, Kiowa Kirin, Synovian, and UCB. Also wanted to just let everybody know about some upcoming lunch and learns that we have to make sure you're aware of them. Hopefully most of you got that information in the email blast that came with the link for today's lunch or webinar. But the one coming up on January 22nd with Dr. Frederick Manfredson, he will be discussing the current research being done in the Parkinson's lab here at Barrow. So be very interesting to see what's going on sort of that basic cellular level in regards to Parkinson's disease. And then February 5th, we have a special lunch and learn series that is going to be presented in behalf of, along with conjunction with us at the Muhammad Ali Center and the Barrow Alzheimer's and Cognitive Disorders Program. And that is a special showing of the movie Spark. The movie Spark actually looks at the life of Robin Williams and his diagnosis of Lewy body dementia. Will be followed by a question and answer session by Drs. Anna Burke and Ryan Walsh here from Barrow. And we'll actually be part of a four-part series. So I hope all of you can attend that as well. More information about that as well as the links for that will come out shortly in a email blast to everybody who's attending today. So again, I want to thank everybody for attending today's workshop, and we look forward to having everybody follow us in the future as well. Debbie Polisky is a bilingual nutritionist, Zumba instructor, wellness consultant, and adjunct faculty who uses mind and body techniques such as mindfulness, stress management, exercise, dance Zumba, yoga, and nutrition to improve the lives of patients, students, and the community. She has over 20 years experience in the healthcare field in two countries, Argentina and the U.S., so her two native languages, English and Spanish. We have had Debbie work with our Hispanic group, and they have greatly enjoyed her sessions with them on how to add some nutrition in for their Parkinson's diet. And so, Debbie, we are very happy to have you today and look forward to what we're going to learn about.
Well, thank you so much, Christina, and welcome, everyone. Thanks for being here. Good afternoon for all our Arizona residents. And if you're here from somewhere else, well, have a wonderful afternoon too. Our weather is great, thank goodness, it's winter time. And I'm so excited to be here. Like Christina said, yes, I've done some activities with you all for the Hispanic community and today in English. And as I always say, well, I'm passionate about the whole mind-body connection, and I'm also passionate about nutrition, because especially in anybody who has a chronic health condition, you're going through so many difficult moments, and especially our current situation. And knowing that we have nutrition, that we have control over what we eat, we have control over how we prep our meals, if we eat colorful or not, if we take some supplements to help us or not. Well, for me, that's wonderful, right? It means that we do have control over some things. So I love nutrition. And today I'm going to go over a whole bunch of fun things. We're going to go through nutrients and supplements. I'm going to now in a little bit talk to you about our objectives for this afternoon. Then we're going to take a little pause. And you can see behind me, I'm welcoming you to my kitchen here in Avondale, Arizona, where we will share some recipes. I know Christina sent those recipes beforehand. I've kind of modified some others. And so we're going to learn how to boost our immune system. And I want to hear from you. I want to hear all of your recipes and any questions you have. Like Christina says, I am here to answer. If we don't get to all of them, no worries. We will get back to you via email. And I love interaction. So we have, like Christina mentioned, our chat box. So whenever I ask any question out there, feel free to, you know, post whatever you like doing related to foods, to meals. And I am glad to share because it's all about sharing. I learn from you and we all learn from each other. So we're going to get started. And again, just use the chat box anytime. What are we going to speak about during this afternoon's presentation? Well, first of all, I want to go through the importance of balanced nutrition. I'm all for keeping a balance, right? It's not about not eating this or not eating the other or good or bad, but how do we balance our meals throughout the day and throughout the week? Next, we're going to go through the different food groups and speak about moderation and variety. And while I am one who loves color, like you can tell, I've got a turquoise blazer, and behind me, my kitchen is just packed with color. So thank goodness for my American mom. She always loved color. And so because of her, I just love color. And we'll speak about eating like a rainbow in just a moment too. Third, we're going to go over the importance of hydration and some ideas, especially now, because I know summer it's easier to stay hydrated, but during the winter months, we don't, you know, feel like we need so much fluids, but we still need to remain hydrated, and sometimes water is a little boring. So we'll go over those topics too. Some side effects we can have of medication, especially if you're taking several types of medication for Parkinson disease as well as others. So you'll learn about there's different drug nutrient interactions and what you can do about that. And we will go over, even here on the PowerPoint, some healthy, simple, and tasty recipes. And then, like I said, we'll have an interval and go back to the kitchen to continue with lots of color today. So let me start by saying, listen to this. Remember Hippocrates, he was the father of modern medicine. And so long ago, he mentioned, let food be thy medicine and let medicine be thy food. So he didn't say start with medications. He didn't say, you know, start with all these complicated tests. He said, hey, let's start with the basics. So what gives us energy? What gives us color? Well, yes, it's food. It's our fuel. It's kind of like starting the car without having the right fuel. Well, the more we learn about our nutrients and balancing them in moderation and how to combine them and how to distribute them throughout the day, well, hopefully we'll feel each time better and better. So let's listen to him, right? He was quite a great physician. And again, like I said, if anyone wants to comment anything in the chat while we speak, please go ahead. So we're going to start with our first survey. As Christina mentioned, we have three surveys today, and I want to learn a little bit about the audience, about what you're all doing usually. And we're going to give you just a little bit of time so you can all it's anonymous, so you can kind of let us know where you're at regarding the question is, do you generally eat less than 5 portions of vegetables and fruits daily, 5 to 9 portions of vegetables and fruits daily, or more than 9 portions of vegetables and fruits daily? Perfect. And we're giving you a few seconds, then we'll close the poll. Excellent. Well, so it seems, oh, wow. So we have 62% of you who mention less than 5 portions of vegetables and fruits daily. And we have 38% of you mentioning 5 to 9 portions of vegetables and fruits daily. Yes, and don't be surprised, because most of us don't get enough of all that color, right? So, and why is that? And let me go back a little bit. What is a vegetable portion, or what is a fruit portion, which we'll also see during our kitchen presentation? You know, my friends, you don't need to eat large portions. So usually they are telling us to try to eat more portions a day. If we can get closer to that 9 portion or 7 to 9 portions daily, even better. And I'll go through it with this next research. There's so much research going on and has been done with PD and nutrition and supplements too. But a portion can be as simple as a cup of raw leafy green vegetables, half a cup of cooked vegetables, maybe some carrots, maybe you've got some squash that you've cooked, or a soup. You can have a smaller medium-sized apple, and that's a portion size. It could be half a banana if your banana is very large. Bananas are high in potassium. So we don't need large portions throughout the day, but as long as we're getting a lot of them throughout the day. And many times I tell people, well, figure out how can you distribute them throughout the day. Does anyone want to add here in the chat, do you want to share what vegetables or fruits are the ones that you usually consume? And I know as you chit-chat here that it's different in winter, obviously, than in summer. But does anyone want to share what is it they are eating these days, now that it's luckily in Arizona, right? It's nice and chilly. And as you all start telling us, oh, wonderful, thank you. I hear people are writing down sweet potatoes and apples, yummy, yum. Lettuce and broccoli, cauliflower, mushrooms, peppers, onions, carrots. Wow, what a great variety. Thank you so much. Yes, anyone else is there wanting to share? Kale, excellent choices. Yes, I see Dolores raise her hand. Dolores, just at this moment, just chat here on the chat button if you can. Berries, spinach, peas, broccoli, zucchini, grapes. I see some melons. Yes. And you know, my friends, I do have a recipe called a watermelon pizza for you. Now that you're here, I hear Dolores here writing. Also applesauce. Thanks for sharing. Kathy says blueberries and orange juice. Oh my goodness. We've got bananas and berries, apples, oranges, squash, zucchini, eggplants, okra, and green beans. Yes, my friends, we've got so many yummy things. You know, in summer, we've got the wonderful, you know, fruits, of course, but in winter, I don't know if any of you go to different farmers markets. I know we're, you know, in a difficult situation, but our dark leafy greens here in Arizona are amazing. Thank you. Veronica's mentioning also some sweet potatoes, white potatoes, and grapes. So yes, lots of green leafy vegetables now in our winter season. Our soup, your yams, your sweet potatoes, your squash. Lots of fun things like last night I did what's called a ratatouille, which is kind of like a whole vegetable stew with some broth, with some tomato sauce, some zucchini and onions and mushrooms, asparagus. Avocados, oh, Fred, of course, that's a must for all of us, right? There's nothing like an avocado a day. They're kind of telling us that avocados are the great healthy fats, and we'll learn about that in just a little bit. Yes, thank you, Mamay. Papaya, pineapple, and avocado as well. Yes, yes. Thank you so much for sharing, persimmons. Thank you, Harshad. And thank you so much, Fred, for sharing. You know, there's so many things out there. And even though it's a little chilly in Arizona, you know, we all year round can have our salads and we can have soups and we can, you know, have our stews. And, you know, I'm going to have some recipes with beans and lentils. So yes, my friends, thank you so much. Thanks for sharing. So with so much color that we mentioned, I want to share with you here on my next slide, the role of nutrition and supplements in PD. Pineapples and oranges, Raymond, thank you so much. And so, you know, I always say, and this is what our research shows, that not only in PD, but in any kind of chronic health condition, our condition starts because we have some inflammation in the body. Some inflammation, and inflammation is the response of our body from our immune system. So luckily, if we have a good, healthy immune system, which is why we're going to have some immune boosting recipes later on, our immune system is prepared to defend us against foreign invaders, bacteria and virus, against maybe foods or chemicals that just don't feel right to us. And even unfortunately, again, sometimes our own tissues or organs. So we have to listen when we feel some kind of a pain or we feel symptoms that are not the way we're usually, feeling, please go to your physician and make sure that everything's okay or what it is so you can be treated. And so because of that inflammation, PD also is a chronic health condition with inflammation. And not only that, I don't know if many of you have heard of the gut-brain connection. So there's what we always say, the mind-body. Well, our brain and our gut, which is our digestive system, is also connected. So it's connected very, very closely. And what research has shown that many times our PD begins in our digestive system, meaning many, many years before they diagnose us, we start having different digestive symptoms. It could be from gastritis to constipation to just inflammation. We just might have different digestive issues going on that just don't feel right to us. And then years later, that inflammation then causes that we start to have neurological issues as well, which brings us to the fact that nutrition is our energy, and it's so important if we can choose wisely to at least see if we can decrease some of the symptoms we may have had or we may have now. So I know from PD, many of you, or maybe some of you, might still have, because of medications, because of the health condition, some GI issues or digestive issues. And that's why I wanted to share with you, this is a slide of research of 2017, of a few years ago, where they analyzed the types of foods and also some supplements that people were consuming in relation to the severity and the types of symptoms people were having. Meaning, if you see in this chart, those in the upper end, meaning what you see in green, you've got some light greens and then you've got some darker greens. Well, those were the individuals who had less severity of their symptoms and less often, because you can see they were consuming nuts and seeds and lots of color. We are saying they eat like a rainbow, the fruits and vegetables. And yes, Harshad, thank you. I hear we're speaking about beetroot, kombucha, ginger, and basils. Exactly. I have some basil here in the kitchen too, coming up shortly. So yes, ginger is anti-inflammatory. So those people who were eating more of the greens, more of the olive oils, the coconut oils, the fresh herbs, the spices, what you were mentioning, Harshad, the ginger, they had less severity and less frequency of their symptoms. And people where you see the red, starting from milk, cheese, yogurt, all the way down to processed foods and canned fruits, those people who were consuming more dairy products, more high fat foods, maybe more saturated fats, we'll go over that, and trans fats, maybe some more sodas, desserts, chocolates, milkshakes, etc., they were having more severe symptoms. And as well, because I know we'll have a slide on supplements, there's so much research going on, we don't have a clear-cut response as to what exactly we should be consuming as far as supplements, yes or no. But in this study, they saw that CoQ10, that you might have heard of, plays a role with our mitochondria, which is our powerhouse in our cells, and fish oil, like the omega-3 supplements, also helped reduce symptoms of these individuals. So here again is at least one research out of many, and I will give Christina all the research for those of you who want them sent to your email box, that nutrition is so important and the quality is essential too. And while I go to the next slide, if any of you want in the chat box to share, what is it you're consuming more of? Is it more of the greens or more of the red? You can write just green or red. And I know you'll be speaking about green is more what we're seeing here, fresh fruits, vegetables, coconut oils, or more of the red, the processed, the dairy, right? And I know we're kind of tired of being stuck at home. I know that we're tired of cooking. You know, I know we're going through some difficult times right now. Red, definitely more red. Oh, you're trying to have salad, Susan, every other day. Wow, wonderful. Thanks, Beatrice and Bonnie. Red. Joanne says a mix of red and green. Okay, mostly green, green. Oh, Susan says she meant green. Okay. Fred mentions 50-50. Oh, Dolores, red, red with big, big bold letters there, right? Yes, you do a mix, David. Okay, but some more red. And I know, my friends, it's not easy. It's not easy to make changes. That's why, like Christina knows, I love to speak about small little mini goals, right? Making changes so they become lifestyle habits, not dieting, but seeing what I can make a change with slowly. Don't get stressed over it. Raymond's making a lot of soups with vegetable. Oh, wonderful, Raymond. Well, last night I made also a delicious lentil soup packed with veggies. You guys can also try making things that last for a few days so you're not, you know, cooking all the time in the kitchen. I know it gets tedious. Thanks, my friends, for sharing. So we're going to go, okay, and I am, Minestrone says, Raymond, Linda saying, where are the cereals? Oh, okay, great question, Linda. Where are cereals in the outcomes? You're right. Well, maybe they didn't study every single food group, and we are going to go over the cereals. So there's a difference, Linda, and all of you out there who might have the same question. We're going to go over what kind of cereals, meaning whole grains, that have more fiber, more vitamin B, those would be, even though maybe they didn't study it in the research, in the greens, while those of all, those cereals that are the sugary kind or refined or white pasta that doesn't have much of anything, well, I would consider that in the red. So I hope that answered your question. We're going to continue, my friends, and my next slide is all about healthy, simple, and tasty meals. So as I said, I personally am also one that does not want to spend hours in the kitchen. I want something that's tasty but simple, and we all do our best for it to be healthy, right? So those of you who said lots of reds, well, how can we slowly go and go into the more of the green section? And here are four topics that I love to mention. Number one, eat a rainbow. Some people say eat like a rainbow. I think it's eat a rainbow. Meaning if you're like me that loves color, or maybe you don't like color, but I want you to add here in the chat, how many of you feel that you're eating a rainbow most days of the week? Nobody's perfect. We're all humans. We're all imperfect. But how many of you feel that 7 days a week, you know, maybe four or five, I'm really eating a rainbow. I get greens, I get yellows, I get red, I get blues, purple, well, even whatever's not on the rainbow, but I get as much color as I can. We're trying. Raymond's trying, of course. Yes, good, Fred. Thank you for sharing. Yeah, so that's the first one. Eating, Susan says yes to the rainbow. Eating a rainbow, trying to see if the three main meals of the day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, we can add some rainbow. You can even, I like to say, have maybe like a little list or a notepad, or maybe an app or something on your cell phone if you're more techie savvy, and kind of jotting down, yes, you know, I got some color at breakfast, at lunch, at dinner, or maybe I didn't get it at breakfast, but I added a little snack, and so I got my little green apple, and later on I got, you know, some beets in a beet salad for, you know, with dinner with my fish. So yes to rainbows. Another topic that's important is avoid diets or avoid dieting. I know PD can be very, very stressful. I had my grandfather from my dad's side, he lived until 91, but he suffered from Parkinson disease in the last like 15 years. So I know how difficult it is, you know, living with a loved one or being oneself with his health condition. But there's a lot out there. We have to be cautious. Always go back to your physician who can tell you yes or nay to, you know, whatever's out there. Look for reliable sources, academic journals. Again, your physician can help you out with the research. But avoiding dieting, because diet means that we restrict ourselves. We slash different food groups. We don't eat one thing, another. And usually they're not sustainable, and they usually may have more harm than any good. Although we will go through different lifestyles that we can, that, you know, I will share with you in one of the slides. And Fred is asking, what's my favorite snack when you get the munchies? Yes, Fred, we're going to go over some yummy snacks in the kitchen in just a little bit, but it really depends on what time of a day. I like to make, Fred and the rest of you who might be interested, making my own trail mix. So if you're buying your own raw nuts and seeds, and then you can salt them or add other spices, whatever you're able to do, and you can roast them in your own oven, that gives you better control of the ingredients. Especially in summer in Arizona, we can go, you know, with our little trail mix to different places. It doesn't need refrigeration. Sometimes, you know, Fred, it could be just an apple. It could be a fruit. It could be just a bowl of berries. I'm going to show you a yogurt parfait that I use for breakfast and also for snacking time. The other thing that's important to know from this slide is planning meals and recipes. So, you know what happens when I have noticed myself, I don't know about all of you, and you can, you know, chat here below, planning meals and recipes. When we are organized And because we have control over our meals, and maybe you go to the grocery store just once a week or once every 2 weeks, you know what you're going to cook throughout the week. You know if you're going to cook, you know, maybe something that lasts for 2 days, so you're not cooking every day. You have all the ingredients, and maybe you prep beforehand. We tend to eat healthier. And when we're a little bit chaotic, disorganized, we're fed up of being in the kitchen, then we tend to, you know, not eat too well. We tend to eat more of those reds or processed foods. And so we, you know, we just don't feel too good. And it's great to feel powerful with things that we have control over, like the foods, right? Now, everyone is different. Susan is mentioning, thank you, Susan. I always say refer to your physician or to your nutritionist if you're working, obviously, with a team, because some of you might have issues, of course. If you have difficulty swallowing, it depends on what stage you're in PD. We're all very, very different. Of course, I would never recommend nuts and seeds. You're absolutely right, Susan. In that case, with swallowing issues, of course, refer to your physician or dietitian, nutritionist. And, you know, they can know exactly what kind, if it's smoothies, if pureed foods, yes. Oh, you gave up on trail mix for your husband. Of course. Yes, my friends, know that I am just generalizing, but I'm not aware of everyone's situation. So thanks, Susan, for bringing that up. And last but not least means don't skip meals, meaning many times I've heard, you know, and I chat with people who are kind of, you know, they're like, I'm not into breakfast, or I don't eat all day and I just have one meal dinner, or we're going to go into our medication like levodopa. And so I'm scared to eat with a protein. And so I just skip my meals entirely. But those of us who have a breakfast, a lunch and dinner, and maybe smaller quantities, so we have then maybe a mid-morning snack or a mid-afternoon snack, depends, we're all different. We are, you know, we're giving our body and our brain as well fuel throughout the day. And who wants to share? Do any of you want to share? What's your style? Do you skip meals? Yes or no, I don't skip meals. You can just answer yes or no while I go on to the next slide. Yes, I skip meals. Yes, I do. Okay. And I see some yes and I see some no's as well. We don't skip meals. Okay. We skip lunch. Yes. Thank you. Yes. COVID. Yes. We're in a very difficult situation. And I guess we are all tired of, you know, cooking and figuring out things. No, you don't, Bonnie. Thank you. Thank you. Of course. Beatrice skips lunch many times. Yes. It's hard. It's hard. Of course. Of course. Sometimes, David, if we can't eat a lot, what I suggest is tiny, you know, very small little snacks throughout the day. I'm going to share with you a little tray I have later on in the kitchen that I'll just show you that, no skipping here, Stephen, okay, with exclamation marks, that can show you that sometimes we don't really want a meal, but we can have little, tiny little things every 2-3 hours. And if your body works that way, that's fine. Snacking later at night, Fred, yeah, some of us are more of the snacking kind, right? So what, you know, what options do we have there? Of course, I don't have for today, but I can obviously send Christina some yummy, we'll share in the kitchen, hummus with garbanzos or chickpeas, right? So there's lots of yummy dips you can have together with some veggies, etc., right? To go snacking on, or also to have for a few days too. Okay, Harshad mentions that your lunch, exactly, is something small like apple, cheese, smoothies. Exactly, exactly. We're all different, and I respect that. That's a good thing. Thank you, my friends, for sharing. Now, on to our next slide here. We're speaking about balance and variety in our meals, right? And here's where there's a government site. You can see in the right, I have a visual that if you want to jot it down, please do so. Or with Christina, we can, you know, remind you later. It's called choosemyplate.gov. The nice thing about this government site is that you can you can, we would say, jot down your own weight, your height, your own activity, and this government site will tell you exactly how many fruits, vegetables, and portion groups you should consume according to the information or data that you provide. It's very complete. It's in English and in Spanish. I've shared it as well with our Hispanic community. There's recipes and they break it down very nicely. And as you can tell, it's kind of divided in half. Half of it speaks about fruits and vegetables, with vegetables like the larger portion. And on the other side, we've got grains and proteins, where grains, and in a little bit we'll go over what type of grains, are the ones that we would consume more than the protein. But some of you might be eating more protein than grains. I understand that. And dairy is out there separate. And I know some of you might not do very good with the dairy. There's dairy alternatives that we'll go over too. We could get the copy. Oh, okay, Harshad is asking. Yes, I'm sure Christina can send you the presentation too. And I'm sorry, Kathy mentions, oh, okay, lunchtime doesn't coincide with your meds. Of course, just follow your physician. Yes, whatever you need to do, please do so, Kathy. Thanks for sharing. And so the different food groups we're going to go over would be vegetables and fruits, protein. They could be animal or plant-based. We have the group of carbohydrates, and the ones high in fiber are the ones we really want to consume in higher quantity. And the fats, there's all kinds of fats out there, but we're gonna concentrate on the omega-3s and unsaturated ones. Perfect. Oh, wonderful. Well, Christina, now my friends, get ready. We've got our second little survey coming up. So get ready to answer. Let's see who gets this right. And the question will be, the food with the highest fiber content is 1 cup of oatmeal, 1 cup of beans, 1 cup of cauliflower, or 1 cup of bananas. And we're just giving you a little bit of time to keep thinking. It seems some of you first said one thing, maybe you change it or not, but sure, feel free to participate. Know that this is anonymous. We're not chasing you, or we don't mind. We're here just to share information. Beautiful, wonderful. So here comes the results. We're sharing our poll results. The food with the highest fiber content is 55% of you mentioned a cup of beans. Yes, you're absolutely right. And then we had a cup of oatmeal or a cup of cauliflower in third place. Yes, my friends, a cup of beans are very, very high in fiber. So whether they're fresh beans, whether they're canned, I don't know if you've seen, but I've even seen in some of our specialty stores, we have frozen beans now. I don't know. Have you seen, have anyone seen that? If you want to share in the chat, I have seen chickpeas or garbanzos in frozen bags, and I had never seen that in the past. So yes, beans are very, very high in fiber. So that's a great way, because fiber is very important for our digestive health. Now, I do know that some of you might not be able to consume large quantities of fiber at once, and you're probably distributing them. But beans, we're going to go over in a little bit, great source of fiber. So you're speaking of beans. That's right. Thank you, Susan. Yes. So I'm speaking of legumes. Yes. The group of legumes means not vegetables in general, but when I speak about legumes, that includes all the beans, such as the lentils, your chickpeas, or also known as garbanzos, and all those beans, navy beans, black beans, your kidney beans. So yes, Susan, thanks for mentioning. Arshad is mentioning, yes, East India means mung, of course. Yes, soybeans. Yes, my friends, that's a group of legumes. Those are very high in fiber, higher than, you know, just your regular veggies, your regular fruits, which, like I said, we need lots of color, but just know that the beans, edamame, yes, too. Yes, Fred, thank you. But more are the beans, right? The whole legumes group. So there's more fiber there in your lentils, your garbanzos, and all the whole group of beans. Thank you so much, my friends. So I'm going to go into each of the food groups so we have a better idea of what, you know, what to pay more attention to. Raymond, yes, the black beans, of course. There's the nice thing, my friends, is there's a whole bunch of variety out there, right? So it's great that we have choices. As far as what carbohydrates are there and what should I be maybe paying more attention to? Well, remember when we spoke about in the beginning that survey, not the survey, the research study where most of you mentioned that you're into more of the reds and not so much greens, right? So when we speak about carbohydrates, it's not about not consuming them, right? Which has been out there as far as dieting and not eating carbs, low carb, no carb. But we want to emphasize the whole grain. So whole grains, and I have some examples in my kitchen. We're speaking about that the first ingredient when you read a food label says whole wheat, it could be the oats. It could be different grains that you're already consuming, like brown rice, like quinoa, like you're consuming maybe whole wheat pasta. Also know that the pasta out there, I love it because there's a lot of pasta now with beans or legumes as different flours making pasta. So if you're not really into or you don't tolerate your regular wheat or you're into gluten-free, there's lots of options out there. Vegetables and fruits, those also are rich in antioxidants, phytonutrients, and fiber. Couscous, that's right, Fred. Yes, couscous doesn't have a lot of fiber, but yes, it is in the group of the whole grains. There's farro, I think I have one of my my little tuppers there, which is an Italian grain. You have rye, you have barley, right? Barley soup's a great one now for this season. And your legumes, where we're speaking about all these amazing beans. And now, Charlie, in my kitchen, I'm going to go over the garbanzo salad, which Christina shared also the recipe, but there it is, there to the right, you know, lots of color. I love the color. And I'll even show how you can transform this garbanzo salad into a soup. So if you're kind of in the cold weather for dinner time, you can have a lunch salad and then you can transform it into soup. That's right, basmati rice too. Yes, of course. Some rice has more fibers than others. So if you guys are looking at, you know, the ones that are like these wild blend rice or brown rice, they have fiber. But anyways, remember what we did with the poll, the legumes, all those beans, think of that as your greatest, greatest source of fiber. Yes, bulgur as well. Susan's asking, bulgur is also considered in this group. That's right. Yes, you're going to see there's lots of, there's buckwheat, right? So millet, there's grains that we, grains and some are seeds that we might not be very, very familiar with. And especially now I'm going to go over diets or lifestyles and do they reduce inflammation or not? But yes, Susan, I want to say that we tend to eat the same thing over and over again, don't we, my friends? Who wants to say that in the chat? Do you usually eat the same thing every week? Say yes if you tend to eat the same thing every week. Or say no if you're the person who loves to modify recipes and you're always looking for new things. Harshad, yes, how about vegan? I'm not sure what you mean by how about vegan, vegan to reduce inflammation. Maybe you can chat Harshad a little bit better there so I can answer. Susan loves to try new recipes. Great. And Linda's saying beans. Mm-hmm. That's right. We're going to go over that in one of our third poll, Linda, about timing of the medication of protein. Thanks for bringing that up. David, more or less the same. Excellent. So my friends, there are several. Yes, and Kathy gets tired. Yes, we get tired of eating the same thing, right? Shelley, yes. Yes. Perfect. Now, if it's if you guys like, you know, you like your routine, you're happy, you feel good with it, of course, please go ahead. You don't have to, you know, spend hours pulling your hair with different kinds of recipes. Yes. So out there, you're going to see lots of research and lots of things out there as far as what should I eat or what diet to reduce inflammation. So remember what I mentioned before. There's not a specific diet or specific foods for PD. It really depends on the stage, on what symptoms we're having, how we have to adapt to maybe digestive symptoms, swallowing, other medications, other health conditions that we have, our likes, our dislikes, our preferences. That's, you know, on the one hand. But let me share with you these four. I call them either diets or lifestyles, so you have where we have efforts. Who are the ones that I mostly refer or recommend? And you can feel free to ask your physician, of course. One is called the Mediterranean diet or lifestyle, and the other one's the mind diet, M-I-N-D, about brain, right? Brain diet or mind diet. And mind diet is a combination of the first one, the Mediterranean diet, as well as the DASH diet, which is a diet known as dietary approach to stopping hypertension for those who have to take care of their sodium levels. Maybe your blood pressure is a little bit higher. So let's go into the first one. Why the Mediterranean diet? Well, if you've looked at research, there's been so much research done, not only for, well, PD and for other chronic health conditions, and Mediterranean diet. So we're thinking about all those amazing European countries that are so fortunate, and their food is concentrated on one, eating a rainbow, lots of fresh produce, vegetables and fruits all year round. So they have farmers markets practically or every day. So they concentrate on simple recipes with lots of produce. They also add a lot of fish, which is wild caught fish. So they're fortunate to be near water and not like us, the desert. So they concentrate on a lot of fish, a lot, which could be also known as with omega-3 fatty acids, healthier fatty acids, using a lot of olive oil is one of the preferred oils that you might hear mentioned, nuts and seeds as well. They consume wine in moderation, not large quantities. And yes, it's not that they don't eat meat or chicken, but usually it's not the grain fed and not all these hormones, but the real pasture fed. So meaning the real deal, right? And their portions usually are in moderation. You might ask me, oh, but, you know, there's like the Italians, right? They've got their pasta and maybe it's not whole grain. Yes, you're right. Maybe it's not. But again, they're also into a lot of exercise and walking a lot, right? They don't go with their cars all over like we do here, right? So they socialize a lot. So there's other factors involved as well. Fred is asking, yes, that's right. Cold-pressed olive oil, what's known as unrefined oils, because Fred, as we all know, it's sometimes very hard at the grocery store. There's a lot of processed oils, right? So here's where I would say sometimes the farmers markets, yes, I know they're pricier, but you know, they have some of our local Arizona people, right? We're supporting them. And at the same time, we're getting high quality, right? Just the best of the best. So Mediterranean diet would be one lifestyle, which is highly recommended. The other second one, like I mentioned, is a combination of Mediterranean and the DASH diet. Here is where they have five foods or ingredients that they don't allow on this MIND diet, which would be processed foods, which would be saturated fats or trans fats, lots of sugars and refined sugars. So everything to do with all of the processing, that's not really into it. While they have 10 food items or ingredients that they're really into, basically the ones I've mentioned in the Mediterranean diet. As far as keto diet, so while I'm talking, I'd love for you all to share here in the chat. Any of you, are you using these diets or lifestyles? Yes, why or why not? I know you don't want to chat a whole lot there, but let me know if you have tried one of these in the past or you're into it and you're finding success with one of them. Excellent. Jean Ann is asking crustaceans, right? So we're speaking, yes, thanks for telling me, seafood. So in the Mediterranean diet, it's not only fish, but yes, they do use different types of seafood. And again, seafood, you might know, has higher quantities of cholesterol, but again, you've got shrimp. Remember when I spoke about everything in balance and moderation, so we're not going to eat seafood every day, but how nice to have a cocktail, right, a shrimps, and we can add maybe some avocado and hearts of palm into it with lemon juice. We don't need a lot of, you know, lots of sauces, right, just keeping it more simple. Okay, thanks, Bonnie. Some of you say no, others have said nothing specific. And Bonnie mentions, yes, so of course, and we're going to go into the last one, gluten-free. Some of you have been diagnosed also with celiac disease. And so you have to be very cautious looking at all these ingredients. There's a lot out there and really simplifying your life, right? So thanks for sharing. So again, I know that PD and the digestive system, very delicate. So each one of us is taking care of different things. Even so, we might not be celiac, but we might be gluten sensitive. So you can speak to your physician because they can test you. So you know if maybe a gluten-free style, lifestyle or diet is beneficial to you. You sometimes don't know until, you know, you also do a kind of trial and error. Let me just go back to keto. So by what you're saying, some of you are on a specific diet plan and others just balance things out. You might have heard of the keto diet. So keto refers to higher fat content than moderate protein and very low carbs. And usually the carbs are basically like leafy greens with fiber, but not the pasta, the breads, the grains, et cetera. So they use maybe coconut oil and flours, almond flours, nuts and seeds, as far as flours to make breads, crackers, et cetera, to fit this lifestyle. And you might have seen the research out there with keto. Yes, some research shows that PD and keto is beneficial. Some people really benefit from this high fat, moderate protein and low, very low carb. Others show that it's very restrictive and hard to follow in the long run, right? So, you know, that's a lifestyle choice, or again, refer to your physician, right? And the gluten-free, I kind of mentioned, yes, it's always a good idea, especially if you've had PD for a while, check with your physician with a blood test. You can always check if you're celiac or if you're sensitive, or even do what I call trial and error. So there's a lot of gluten-free out there. When I speak about gluten-free, I don't speak about all these processed products, my friends, because if you start reading labels, which is, well, a whole other topic and conversation, all the nutrition labels and figuring all that out, well, anything that has so many ingredients on a label, well, we know it's not a great thing, but keeping it simple, gluten-free, trying it out for maybe 2 weeks, you can see, maybe you start to feel better if you're having bloating symptoms or constipation or gassy or some kind of inflammation, and it might help you. It might even help you better focus and clarity. But I just wanted to share with you that there are these diets or lifestyles out there. Oh, okay. Well, Christina, we've got our third survey, our poll, my friend. So get ready for this one. And so our last poll speaks about it's important to avoid taking the medication levodopa while consuming fats, fiber, proteins, sugars. And we're going to give you just a little bit of time to figure out what do you think, right? I mean, if probably all of you are on levodopa and maybe some of you have just been diagnosed or you have a loved one that, you know, they're checking to see if this person has PD or you've had for a while. So maybe your physician or your dietitian, your nutritionist have been speaking about this. And we're just waiting so everyone has a chance. Whoever wants to participate, this is anonymous. And again, we're just sharing information here. Wonderful. And so 61% of you mentioned it's important to avoid taking the medication levodopa while consuming proteins. That is correct. And then a few others had the other options, which were fats, fiber, and sugars. Yes, thanks, Christina, so much. That's correct, my friends. We're going to go over now protein. Basically, if you speak to your physicians, this is something that they will tell you right from the beginning, right? If you're taking your medication, take it away from protein-rich foods to avoid interactions, right? So each one can be well absorbed. They tend to say 30, 40, 45 minutes taking medication away from a protein-rich food, which is why I want to go into what types of proteins are out there. So when you have to take your meds, feel free to talk to your physician or nutritionist, as well as you will already have a better idea what has protein and what wouldn't be a good mix due to the absorption. So as I speak about proteins, feel free, my friends, in the chat to share what type of proteins do you consume on a regular basis. This doesn't mean every day, but maybe, you know, throughout the week. We basically have two types of groups. We have the animal-based protein, which includes your meats, your chicken, your turkey, fish, your eggs, the dairy. All those have protein or animal protein. Now, if you ask me, you know, what kind of, I was telling you before, if you can get your meats grass-fed pasture, right, grass-fed your turkey, your chicken, with all this, avoiding all this hormones issues going on, even better. Fish, we're going to go into more details now with our healthy fat, a wild-caught fish, omega-3 rich fatty fish. Eggs as well, you know, eggs, it's unfortunate that our whole food system is chaotic now, but check to see if you can get eggs, you know, either from your local people, which I, again, try to support as much as I can, your local farmers, or eggs that are enriched in omega-3, not chickens that have been grain fed. And then plant-based, and meanwhile, thank you, my friends. I don't want to miss out on the chat. We've got those of you speaking about yogurt, ice cream, and chicken. So again, your dairy, your milk, your cream, correct? Your yogurts, all your cheese. Yes, they're rich in protein. Exactly. Thank you, Fred and Harshad. Plant-based, yes. Cheese and beans, nuts and seeds. Thank you for sharing. So that's right, Harshad. Plant-based includes the legumes that we spoke about so highly with all their fiber, all your beans and grains, especially if they're whole grains, your nuts and your seeds. And nuts and seeds are also in our next slide talking about healthy fats. Excellent. And I have Fred asking me a question, which is, what's our opinion of farm-raised fish? Well, again, my opinion is try to stay away. And again, I know there's cost issues and, you know, we're all on a budget, but we can eat healthier on a budget, but try to see as much as you can buy organic if possible, local if possible, and wild caught fish if possible. That would be great, right? Because it is unfortunate that who would think that we've got each time, you know, more complications with the way they're feeding our fish, our chickens, our cattle, etc. Thanks, Fred, for bringing that up. As far as what fats are the ones that we want to pay more attention to, well, we've got these different groups. And feel free to share below, what kind of fats do you usually consume? Louise asked me, yes, sunflower seeds, my friend. Thanks for mentioning, Louise. Sunflower seeds, Yes, not only do they have protein, but you're going to find them here in this slide with our omega-3s. So great addition if you're not having swallowing issues and if your physician says you're okay with them. As I mentioned with other things, I always try to say that if there are seeds, try to get them raw, and then at home, try to roast if you like roasting, and adding salt or some other spice or whatever else you can, you know, consume, right? Instead of buying what's already oily and already roasted from the store. So fats that you're consuming, yeah, feel free to share below. We've got the saturated are the ones that are solid in room temperature, right? So they're usually associated with like your butters, your lards, that I know they're delicious, and everything from my slide to the right, the picture, right? I mean, all these, what we call also trans fats, so hydrogenated. So all the oily, yummy stuff that we love, all the fried yummy, the donuts and all those pastries and all the fried, foods that we might consume. Well, those are the ones we want to decrease, everything in moderation. And the ones we want to increase would be omega, so fatty, like your wild sardines, asking your seeds and nuts. And as far as oils, well, I know that we're speaking about olive oil to cook. Sometimes I know people ask me, well, olive oil doesn't have a high temperature rate as far as, you know, I don't want to burn my onions and garlic. In that case, try your avocado, coconut oils as options. And I do want to refer to cholesterol because, you know, there's been so much with, oh, you know, I can't eat anything with cholesterol. Some of you might have to take care more or less, but I just want you to note when you look at food labels that cholesterol is only found in animal foods. So even though an oil says no cholesterol, well, obviously an oil is plant-based. And one of the recipes that Christina has sent you, I'm not going to do it today, but you'll see how simple it is an avocado smoothie. So I love to use, and you're going to see many recipes out there that use avocado because it's so creamy, because of its great fat content, right, or healthy fat content called monounsaturated fatty acids. They use it to make chocolate mousse for your smoothies, for nut butters, and maybe you guys have some other options besides guacamole, and well, who doesn't love avocado if you can consume it? And I apologize, I might have missed some of you. Mm-hmm. Olive, I'm seeing here Susan mentioning olive oil and grapeseed oil. Yes, yes, like I mentioned, sometimes we have an issue, like I do too, you know, if it's olive oil just to cook something little, fantastic. But if you have to leave it at a higher temperature, be sure, yeah, grapeseed oil is an option, or I mentioned the coconut, the avocado oil. Shelly's mentioning, okay, raw, okay, any nuts, exactly. And I'm sorry, I apologize. Let me see if I missed something. Oh, Veronica's asking, thank you. Nut butters, I'm sorry, no, are dry roasted nuts better? You know, like I say, getting it raw is the best option. You might want to just eat it raw if that suits you and you're fine with that in your digestive system or your loved one. But obviously it's tastier. Yes, dry roasted, that's great, right? That's a great, great option. So I know some of you are mentioning these kind of options. Yes, yes. What I always say is better raw just because you can control your ingredients. Like I'm going to share with you in my kitchen in just a little bit, a homemade granola, which is also in the recipes that we send to you, right? Because when I can control my ingredients, I can add what fits my needs and what's good for me. Black olives, Raymond, and black olives. Yes. So olive oils and, of course, good olives are also high in monounsaturated fats. Let's go, my friends, into hydration and dehydration. So like I mentioned before, in summer, it's easier to stay hydrated. And in winter, we might go for walks or we might, you know, do activities, or, you know, we might be at home and we just don't feel that hydration is important. So I just want to let you know, yes, how do we calculate basic hydration? But again, we're all different. They usually say take your weight in pounds and then divide by half. And that'll give you how many ounces, right, we should consume of water or something that's high in water. Having said that, look, I'm going to take a little break. So if anyone wants to drink water or something, please do so. As well as if you want to share in the chat below, what is it you like to hydrate with? Feel free to do so. Hydration ideas. So what doesn't hydrate us? Well, things with like coffee, caffeine, and wines dehydrate us. But here are some interesting ideas. Oh, okay. And I'm sorry if I am missing. Wait, let me go back here. Dolores, yes. Thank you, Dolores. I am going to speak about weight loss and weight gain in just, I think, the next slide. So just give me a moment there. I'm here. I'm seeing water. Thank you, my friends. Some of you might just hydrate with water and you're thrilled. Others might find it super boring, right? So what I call infused water, like a pitcher of water, you can add fresh herbs like basil, like mint leaves. Maybe you add some berries. Maybe some of you love cucumber. Great for your skin and great for hydration. In summertime, I like to just get the watermelon and the melon and just, it's not even juicer because I don't even have a juicer. I just, you know, use the blender, even the food processor, and just let it blend with ice, with water. You can use coconut water, also great for hydration with lots of electrolytes. How many of you want to share in the chat? Do you do your own juices or smoothies? That's why I shared the avocado smoothie recipe. I know it's winter time and smoothies might not be like, you know, our typical thing. We want something hot, not such cold beverages, but smoothies are a great way or a great, I call it, vehicle to get a whole bunch of nutrients. So it could be based water, it could be coconut water, it could be based in milk, your regular dairy, it could be plant-based milk like almond, coconut milk, rice milk. You know, you know, there's so much out there nowadays. You can add fruits, you can add, some of you might like pineapple with lots of kale. I know some of you mentioned kale and spinach in our beginning slides. You can add nuts and seeds. So for those of you who have a difficult time swallowing, having a smoothie's great way to add a lot of nutrition. You can add protein powders, you can add nut butters, a great vehicle to add a lot of nutrition into a smoothie. Also note that vegetables and fruits generally, the general group, have about 90%, 92, 95, 98% of water. So just know that you're eating lots of veggies and fruits throughout the day together with water, other things is great, right? You know you're getting your hydration. And milk and yogurts also have about 80, 81%. So there you also have other hydration ideas. And let me see, because I kind of lost myself in the chat. I'm sorry. Oh, okay, Linda, thank you. Green tea, of course, you can add ginseng and honey. I also want to say, because we're going to speak about our immune system, ginger. How many of you love ginger? You can make cold tea, you can make hot tea, right, with ginger slices of lemon, Harsha. Thank you so much. No smoothies for Susan. Okay. Harsha, drinks with a straw, of course, whatever works for you, my friends. Mm-hmm. Yes, so Fred speaks about fresh fruit smoothies. Yes, more for summer, right? Excellent. Thanks, Veronica. Seems a delicious recipe she's sharing of coconut milk, water, a handful of berries, a handful of spinach. You're getting your beta carotene. Amazing. You're getting your fibers, antioxidants from your berries, you're getting your rainbow, your coconut milk with electrolytes. Kathy loves smoothies. Oh, you don't take the time. Well, Kathy, you know, I don't know if today we have time, but I could always send with Christina. The wonderful thing of smoothies is we can also, what I call meal prep. So you can have Kathy in your freezer, you know, like maybe one day of a week, prepare little baggies with a label and just prepare the content of the smoothie there. So maybe one is berries, maybe you chop some bananas, so you have some frozen bananas, right? You've got your little spinach or your kale. So that saves you time. You grab the baggie the next morning, whatever water, milk, whatever coconut water you're using, right? And then if you want to add some protein or some other thing into the smoothie, it's quicker. Yes. So I know time is an issue for all of us. Perfect, my friends. Let's go over quickly some side effects of medication. And I know this is a big one because we're all taking maybe one or more medications. We're in different stages of our health condition. So I will just go quickly because I want to leave time for the kitchen recipes. Some of us might have nausea. And one great thing you might, just one suggestion out of many, is we spoke about using ginger. So ginger has been known, fresh ginger as a tea or in water, helps with nausea. Edema, which means that maybe you've got water retention, and so maybe your legs are a little swollen and your physician says, hey, cut down on sodium-rich foods. So those would be a hot, you know, cutting down on all these processed foods, staying and sticking to eating a rainbow. Weight loss. One of you was asking me, and I know weight loss is an issue, right? We, again, because of different things going on in your health. A few tips I can give you about weight loss, and I can continue when we're in the kitchen. Sometimes eating small meals several times a day helps. Sometimes adding high calorie ingredients into your meals. So if you are okay with cheese is a great dairy to add to different meals. Trying to not have like just water, but again, transforming your water into a smoothie, like I mentioned before, packs you with lots of nutrients and it's fluid, so you digest it quickly. Having a little handful of nuts and seeds are high in fats, good fats and protein. They also help us gain some weight. Not so much salads, but maybe more raw cooked veggies together with some beans and grains give us more nutrients. And constipation, which we can have for different reasons as well, there we want to speak a lot about hydration, which we just went over, getting enough hydration together with high fiber foods, which we've also mentioned, like our legumes, our bean group, right, and others. And let's finish off with supplements. So those of you who have been with your physicians or have had PD a while, you've looked into research. We all know there's a lot going on there. And I know you're going to be asking me, hey, do I take this? Do I take that? Basically, you know, there's research that has mentioned some of these. CoQ10, I've spoken about that in the first 2017 research, where CoQ10 has been used and has been helpful to some people, right? And then they've done other research that no, CoQ10 isn't very helpful. We know some people and we know research with the fish oils or omega-3 supplements that helps because it's anti-inflammatory or helps with our brain health. And people have been successful there. As far as probiotics, you might have heard probiotics, even prebiotics, very helpful for our digestive health. We always want to see if we can consume first the fresh food. So maybe if we can get kefir, kombucha that was mentioned, sauerkraut, our yogurts, our Greek yogurt, great in protein, great in probiotics, before taking all these supplements. Because, you know, my concern in general with supplementation is that our country does not regulate supplementation. So you get a lot of marketing, you have a lot of neighbors and friends telling you, oh, this is wonderful, take this, I sell the other. You've got a lot of ads on TV that we're all, you know, busy watching, staying at home, but there's not a lot of regulation. So we have to really be cautious as far as, you know, what we're taking. Step number one, you've heard me mention several times, let's go back to our physician and let's see what he or she mentions, right, before taking things, because many of your professionals might be also linked to certain health grade supplements where they get not only discounts, But they're supplements that are not found in your regular drugstores, but they might be a little bit more pricier, but they're higher quality with labs that have more research and third parties making sure that they go through all these other regulations or what's known as GMP, good manufacturing practices. So with that, my friends, I want to finish here because I want some time for the kitchen. I want us to cook and share recipes. I want you to, well, hopefully nourish your body with lots of color, lots of love. I'm glad to answer questions. Or Christina, would you like us to take a little break and then come to the kitchen where I will continue answering more questions?
Debbie, I think I want to say thank you. First of all, it has been just very informative. I think let's give everybody a maybe just a 5 minute break. We'll get ready to start in just 1 minute, everybody. So if you want to get ready, Debbie's just getting switched over to her kitchen. Just wanted everybody to know that after the end of this webinar, you will receive a link along with our virtual resource fair to visit some of our sponsors for today's event, as well as the link to Debbie's slideshow and the recipes that she talked about, and then some of the new ones that she's adding in right now that we'll be adding in today while she's over cooking in the kitchen. Also along will be a evaluation. If you wouldn't mind filling that out and just emailing that back to us, that would be wonderful. If you have any problems with that, please, you can get back with us and we are happy to help you. Debbie, are you all ready?
Yes, Christina, I just want to make sure you see the kitchen okay, or?
I can, I'm ready to start cooking.
Well, wonderful, so thanks, my friend. So those of you who have stayed, thanks for your patience, thanks for staying with us. And like Christina said, she'll be helping me because whatever you write in the chat, I can't really see from so far. So she'll be helping me with that. And as she mentioned, she sent you recipes. Some I'll do, I've got others that, you know, I'll just share with you kind of chit-chatting. But basically we wanted to complement our PowerPoint webinar with just some ideas in the kitchen. Some I've mentioned to you, but it's always nice when we see it kind of live, right? Especially because we wanted to share, it's winter time, we wanted to share how to boost our immune system, right? So different ways to do so with, as you see, eat a rainbow, right? And I just want, before starting recipes, on this side, you guys can see lots of color with what we spoke about, the fresh produce, with all the research we saw in the past. So if, like I mentioned before, you can go to your local farmers or, you know, pay more attention to going in the grocery store instead of at all the aisles, but the peripheral. And so you've got all kinds of colorful cauliflowers. I always say try different things, right? Just keep it simple. So maybe you haven't tried a yellow cauliflower, give it a try. I've got lots of kale and red cabbage. I don't know how many of you, and you can, in the chat, and Christina can share with me, how many of you are into like portobello mushrooms, right? Are you using mushrooms that are very high that help boost our immune system? You can grill them. Now that the weather is beautiful, I love to grill and roast a lot of the vegetables like eggplant, like portobello mushrooms. So if you're out there barbecuing, maybe your chicken, your meat, your fish, add some veggies as well. Even this, I don't know if some of you are familiar with our spaghetti squash, right? So it really looks like a spaghetti. It's high in fiber. I roast it in the oven and it's really, really yummy. So if you're taking care of your carbs or the regular pasta, this is a great option. We've got our fresh herbs. I've got some parsley and basil I'll be using too. And on the other side, I have all the colorful fruit. So I know watermelon is already almost out of season, but I just wanted to share a recipe with you. If you still find some melon or watermelon, feel free to do it. Lots of fruits, grapes, and while avocado also is considered a fruit, and many of you said that you loved avocado, as well as I sent you a smoothie recipe using avocado. So Christina, did anyone mention anything in the chat so far?
Not yet.
Wonderful, wonderful. So my friends, what can we do? I'm going to share one thing. What can we do, like some of you mentioned, when you really don't want to cook, right? You're tired of being at home, you're tired of cooking, but you want to make sure that you're getting the different food groups, maybe for lunch, maybe a snack or dinner time. I personally like to prepare what I call a little platter. And here it is for everyone to see. A great variety, for example, here I have my protein. These are mozzarella slices with some basil, some oregano, and olive oil. If you're not into the cheese, you could have maybe some tuna there. You can have some hard-boiled egg. In the middle, I have a little bowl of nuts. So my own little roasted trail mix that I mentioned to you. And then here around it, I have some orange little peppers, those little mini peppers that come in a bag, the yellow peppers. Some asparagus also, very low in carbs, high in fiber, high in hydration. Some dried fruit. I know we mentioned a lot of nuts and seeds, but some of you who are trying to gain weight, dried fruits like apricots in this case, here I got some of our microgreens here from Arizona. So dried fruits like raisins and apricots, figs and dates are a great way to pack a lot of nutrients, high in minerals, and also help us gain weight. So that's one tip I wanted to say, because I know we don't always want to cook something in the kitchen. Another little recipe I'm going to do for you is called a watermelon pizza. So I know you can then save this more for summertime, because our watermelon is practically out of the season, but what I like to do that I did mention in the webinar is use the watermelon for hydration in a little blender. There in the back, you see I have a large blender. I have my little mini blender. I just blend it with ice cubes and water, so great for hydration. And watermelon is very high in vitamin C, which is a very potent antioxidant, which is great to keep our immune system nice and healthy. So what I like to do when you say, what in the world is a watermelon pizza? If you guys have little ones or grandkids or there's family members at home, you first, you can do all this together, right, as a family. You slice your watermelon. So this is what it looks like. This is equivalent to the dough. Instead of the bread, Christina, we've got a little dough of watermelon high in vitamin C. The next step we do is we add for our sauce, which in a pizza, you would have a tomato sauce or a white sauce. So here I'm going to use a white sauce. And in this case, I have a yogurt. I personally like to use a lot. If I do use yogurt, the dairy, and you're able to have your dairy, would be your Greek yogurt. And I love yogurt, which is plain, natural, without a flavor. So if I want to add something, I prefer adding my own strawberries, my own blueberries, and not buying all the flavored stuff. So that's just me. So we add, we would say our pizza cream or sauce right here on our little watermelon. So we've got some fresh fruit, and there we've got some of the dairy, which is high in vitamin D. Vitamin D also, you probably read during 2020, very great for our immune system to boost it, plus the calcium and the protein of your yogurt. And then I love berries. So if you love berries too, it doesn't have to be berries. You can share with Christina what fruits you prefer. So I like to add to this watermelon pizza some slices of blackberries and strawberries, raspberries. You could add kiwi, you could add, whatever you like, slices of banana. And so you see how it's getting very nice and colorful right here. Perfect. I don't know if you can see it or not, but let me add it there. And so what you can do then is, let me see if I am missing one little thing, which I like to, wait, give me just a second. I thought I had it. Oh yeah, I do. I'm sorry. I have it right behind me, which is a little, just a little drizzle of honey. If you, you know, like local honey, fantastic. Honey is, you know, kind of a one of the sweeteners. It's not the one you have to use. Another thing I might sometimes add to this would be mint leaves or some basil leaves. And so there you have it. You have a cute little snack. You can cut it in four. And it's got watermelon. It's got berries. You can add, like I said, the mint leaves, fresh herbs, the drizzle of honey if you wish, and some fresh fruit. So this is one little snack, right? Or another option of hydration. Anything out there, Christina, that I should be aware of while I kind of move this out of the way?
Arshad was letting us know that some additional supplements that are really common and good are an ashwagandha root, lion's mane, turkey tails, turmeric, holly basils.
Thank you, Ashok. Thank you so much. Yeah, so of course, we're always saying this, the more we research and learn from each other, the better. So yes, if you're trying to boost your immune system, which is what we're speaking about today as well, of course, always think the more natural. So we're speaking about having these herbs maybe outside. I have a little patch there where I grow some little greens, some tomatoes, some herbs. You can, if you don't have a lot of space here, have something in your kitchen counter. And as Hashad says, there's so many spices out there that are great for our immune system and herbs. So yes, turmeric is great for the curcumin, that yellowish color. That's great for anti-inflammatory. We ginger before in the webinar. Remember I mentioned that if you have nausea, but also to boost your immune system, feel free to use fresh ginger in your meals, in your stir fries, in your soup stews, or ginger tea. Instead of buying those bags and processed, just have boiling water and add fresh ginger, garlic, onions, right? Those are great. I mean, the more natural we can, and again, start slowly, right? So mini goals here. It's not trying to dump ourselves with everything for 1 week and then that's it. So yes, thanks for sharing.
Linda also suggested some drizzle of organic maple syrup on the watermelon.
That's perfect, Linda. Yes, I was going to mention that too. Don't think that I just speak about one thing and not another, because we're all different and we're using different things. And here in my kitchen, I have as well, I've got some agave, I have honey, I have maple syrup. Look for the pure maple syrup, of course. There's lots of sweeteners out there. I even use sometimes coconut sugar, you know, if I want, instead of the cane sugar. So no, there's lots of options, right? Not one or the other, just use what you prefer. I'm going to go into our yogurt parfait. So this is one that I love for breakfast or for snack. And why? Because it also boosts our immune system. And those of you who mentioned in the webinar that you wanted to gain weight, well, this is a yummy snack or breakfast that you can use any time of day. You grab a little cup or you buy it at the dollar store. I kind of always tell people I like to just pamper yourself, right? Whether you're eating alone or eating with some, you know, family member, a cute little cup from the dollar store is always very enticing, right? So here I've got basically three ingredients. You know what I forgot with, I'm sorry, I just remembered. I remembered that I forgot something. I knew something was missing from the watermelon pizza. You know what else you can add that I have here? I just forgot them. Some walnuts, some pistachios, almonds. We spoke so much about roasting at home. So you can also add that, or some seeds, chia seeds, flax seeds. That's a great way to boost your immune system with healthy fatty acids for the watermelon pizza. So I apologize about that one. With the yogurt parfait, so simple and so much fun. Berries or fruits, again, use you know, sliced apples, bananas, pineapple, kiwi, whatever you like as far as fruit. Then you can add your nuts. Here I've got my walnuts. Remember we spoke about omega-3 fatty acids, so some walnuts. Another option, doesn't have to be nuts. If you want to add granola, I'm going to share with you, I've got my ingredients in the back, my own homemade granola, and I know Christina sent you the recipe. So you can either add nuts or you can add granola. And the third ingredient could be a dairy or non-dairy, some kind of a yogurt that you prefer. I'm just here because I'm just using the Greek. But again, no, if you are vegan, vegetarian, macrobiotic, and or you just prefer those, of course, know that there's coconut yogurt, there's almond yogurt, soy, there's so many options out there. And then you can just add, you know, a little, this you can also drizzle it with some maple syrup, as I think Linda mentioned. And here you just have a simple idea that also boosts your immune system because of the antioxidants of your berries, the vitamin D of your yogurt, the high content of omega-3s from your walnuts. So Christina, we can tell our friends, if any of you, do any of you do something similar to this or you want to share a recipe, please do so.
Debbie, a quick question from Shelley. What is the difference between anti-inflammatory and increasing your immune system when we're talking about foods?
Oh, okay, fantastic. What a great question. Who asked that?
Shelley.
Oh, Shelley, thanks, Shelley. Yeah, so great question, Shelley. Well, when we speak or when you read an article or something online, boost your immune system. We can boost our immune system in many ways, right? And just one way is the one we're focusing today would be how to choose certain foods that are anti-inflammatory. Because as I mentioned in the beginning of our webinar of PD, PD as well as any other chronic health condition begins because there's some inflammation in our body. And our immune system is the one responsible to defend us against either, like I mentioned, bacteria, virus, or something from the outside, some contaminants, chemicals, foods that our body doesn't, you know, respond well to, or even, unfortunately, those who have autoimmune health issues attacks our own tissues and organs. So when I speak about anti-inflammatory foods, I mean, these are ingredients or herbs, spices, or specific foods that have maybe properties like vitamins E, C, vitamin D, antioxidants. So they have certain nutrients or properties that help decrease inflammation. But when we speak about, like you're asking, boost our immune system, food and food ingredients is just one way to boost your immune system. But you're going to read about many others. For example, walking, exercising, you know, if you like, yoga, breathing. Some of us do journaling, meditation, and that also helps boost our immune system. Positive affirmations, writing in a journal. So those are all amazing ways of socializing with those that we love or good friends of ours. Those are great ways, the whole mind-body connection, the great ways to boost our immune system. I hope that answered the question, Linda, Christina.
Yes, thank you. And Harshad suggested also, as you were talking about things you can add to the fruit and yogurt parfait, pecans, goji berries, hemp.
Of course. Thank you, Harshad. Of course. Yes. You know, as I always mentioned, Christina, these are just ideas, my friends. Nothing is set in stone. I am very happy because you are the creative chefs, as I always say, in your own kitchen. And what works for you might not work for the next person. So feel free. If this doesn't work, you prefer one nut, a pecan, feel free to add it. Yes, there's lots of amazing ingredients out there. So kind of like Harshad was saying, it's just a question of starting slow and experimenting, you know, step by step to see what works for you and what ingredients you just want them to be part of your regular food habits, right? So, Christina, I'm going to go while our friends continue chatting, which is wonderful. Thank you so much. I'm going to go to the next one because I have this and another recipe left. And this is more of a salad, and it's the salad I mentioned in our webinar, which was the chickpea or garbanzo salad. So why did I mention that, and why am I going to do it right now? And Christina sent you the recipe. Because this also helps us boost our immune system. Here you can tell in my little bowl, I've got already garbanzos in the bowl. What are the options? Remember, we mentioned legumes are very high in fiber, right? Great for our digestive system, great for prebiotics, probiotics. We have different options. Some I have found in the grocery store or specialty stores. You can find garbanzos in bags, like already frozen, ready. You can find them, I have here, this is what I use, just a quick version, cans with no salt added, organic if possible. Or I also use, like you can tell here, I use, of course, the main thing is to use fresh. So here I've got some red lentils as far as my grains. I've got quinoa that sometimes comes like this with several colors. That's from Central America. Farro, which is more a grain from Europe, like Italian. So this same salad, you don't have to use chickpeas if you're not into it. You can make the same salad with lentils or with these other grains too. I make a lot of salad with the first one, the farro, which is a wheat base. So of course, first option would be fresh, and you can cook it in a slow cooker, in the pressure cooker, a regular pot. Next option, well, there's the frozen, which obviously is pricier, or some kind of can. And the cans, of course, not the best option, but if you can get without salt added, you can rinse it in a strainer and get rid of part of the sodium. That's great, especially if you're taking care of also sodium or blood pressure issues. So to this salad, like you saw, it was so colorful in our webinar, what I like to add are, I've got it here chopped, cucumbers, which we mentioned are high in hydration, so, and great for our skin, so great benefits there, and it gives it already some green to it. I have also chopped different colorful peppers. So Christina, if any of you want to share with Christina, are you into eating bean salad? Say yes or no. Do you add peppers? Do you like these colorful peppers? Basically, you can see in the grocery store, we have orange peppers, yellow, red, and green peppers. All are high also in vitamin C, which is an antioxidant, great for, again, boosting our immune system. So I've got some orange peppers chopped. You can chop them in cubes, you can chop them, you know, in, I don't know, in little longer if you prefer. And I've also chopped some yellow peppers. Again, they are high in vitamin C, and our beans, any kind, as well as the garbanzos that I have here, not only are we speaking about fiber, we're speaking about plant-based protein, we're speaking about carbs, which have the fiber as well. We're speaking about vitamins, minerals. So great, great things. And with these chickpeas, you can also prepare the hummus, which is that famous dip that you might find in, or spread you might find at the stores. And you can add it to that first little dish that I mentioned to you when you're maybe into more of a snacking and you don't want to really prepare a meal. What else would I add to this? I'm cutting here these little cherry tomatoes, and who knows what's in the tomatoes as far as nutrients. Does anyone want to share with Christina something out there in the chat? What are tomatoes high in? I'm adding these to our little preparation here.
Linda says lycopene.
Oh, excellent. Excellent. Thank you. Yes, Linda, you're right. So lycopene, that's great. If you've read years ago, for our men friends that are might be on the call, lycopene is great for prevention of prostate cancer, prostate issues, as well as lycopene is also in your tomato sauce. And also tomatoes are high in the same thing, the vitamin C, again, boosting our immune system. So again, you don't need to use these veggies. You can add radish. I've got some fresh radish here, but this is what your little salad looks like. And you know what I like to add here? If you have some fresh cilantro, if you have some fresh parsley, if you want basil, mint leaves, just grab your little plant here of whatever and just throw in that. Why? Because I also mentioned to people, it's also important, Christina, to have different texture. When we don't always want to eat the soup or a smoothie, right? I mean, we want, if we're able to, and I know some of us aren't, but if we're able to, try to have different textures in your meals. So look, I can even smell the parsley. I wish you'd all come in to the kitchen and have a little mouthful. But look, here's what the salad looks like. And I know you're going to ask me, so what do you do as far as dressing? So my friends, basically, since I come from Argentina, Latin America, we never have been used to, you know, all these store-bought dressings, that those things never existed. So basically, always keep it simple, more like the Mediterranean lifestyle. Basically, someone was asking me some kind of olive oil, extra virgin, unprocessed. Some of them come from Spain, Italy, maybe local. So I personally would add a little bit of olive oil, if that works for you. Then I would add a little acid. Maybe an acid could be a vinegar. It could be a lemon or lime juice. I've got a red wine vinegar here. I have also added here, because I know people ask about, they read a lot about this, which is apple cider vinegar, raw, unfiltered. So some of you might be taking this kind of like a supplement or medicine. Great too. And then you can add salt, pepper, if that's what your salads are, you usually eat, consume. If you can't consume salt, and for God here, like a mixture of herbs. You might prefer spicier things, so feel free to share with Christina what is it you usually like to add to your salad. And remember I mentioned, and I was mentioning to all of you, how can you transform this into a soup? Because maybe we're not into salads because it's winter time. So my friends, basically, except for the cucumbers, which, well, I don't know if some of you, I don't really cook the cucumbers, but the rest of the ingredients, you can have a broth, you can add onions, garlic, your ginger, turmeric, all the yummy anti-inflammatory spices that we mentioned before. And you can transform this minus cucumber into a nice hearty stew or a hearty soup for, I don't know, the evening or for another day. So this is an option. Oh, and one more thing, Christina, is that if some of you love to stuff peppers or tomatoes or eggplant or mushrooms, this is very nice. I basically prepared for you all. This is a tomato. I took out the pulp, the inside. And so you can stuff a tomato, a pepper, I don't know, give me ideas, whatever else you want to stuff with this salad. And so also, it's just a nice way to serve it, right? Or if you have guests, you have, your little entree with your tomato and the garbanzo salad all mixed up. Some of you might like curry, right? And might add curry as well. I will stop talking. Christina, tell me what our audience is mentioning.
So I just want to backtrack just for a moment, Debbie, if you would. Your video broke up just slightly while you were telling us the spices that you were looking at maybe putting in the salad. So if you could just tell us those spices once more, that would be lovely.
Of course, I apologize. So I was mentioning, Christina, that olive oil, could be an option, or some oil that you prefer, maybe avocado or some other oil. I mentioned an acid such as a vinegar. I mentioned maybe limes or fresh lemons. I also mentioned some of you might use apple cider vinegar as a kind of supplement every day. And I mentioned that maybe some of you use just salt or salt and pepper as far as regular spices. But if you're not able to consume salt, you're taking care of your blood pressure or other issues, some options, and there's many, could be oregano, if that's something you like, or even fresh oregano, of course. Herbs, these are like herbs de Provence, which is just a mixture of herbs out there. Some of you might like spicy, or some of you might like curry. So those are all options. You might also, like we mentioned before, add some chopped garlic, chopped onions, ginger into this salad.
Great, thank you. And Fred had a question. With many Parkinson's patients, they lose their sense of taste. So he was wondering, what spices do you suggest that can help boost that taste of food?
Yes, well, thank you so much, Fred, for that question. Well, anything that works specifically for you, right? Because when it comes to, you know, taste, like you say, you know, it's so difficult to know, but if you, Fred, are okay with like spicier options, then please go ahead. You know, we've got so many peppers out there, and we've got more jalapeno style or less spicier. Now, if that's not good, but you prefer something more like I mentioned, the ginger is quite strong. Our garlics are quite strong. Usually if we're speaking about turmeric, it's very mild, right? But ginger is a great flavor and, you know, can boost those taste buds, right? As well as if we're speaking about, you know, something sweet. So we mentioned before, like the honey or the maple syrup, right? To give a little bit more flavor to some sweeter dish or that yogurt parfait.
Perfect. Thank you. Jean also said, as a little side note to her salad, she likes to slice the mini peppers and saute them in a touch of olive oil before adding them.
Beautiful. That's wonderful, Jean. Yes. Yes. If you want to, like we said, you might even for these kind of salads or soups, like we mentioned before, you might want to barbecue or roast or grill exactly or with oil, right? Just give it a flavor, right? Give it more flavor beforehand and then add it to your salad, of course. That's a great observation.
Perfect. Debbie, as a rule of thumb, do you find the order that we should try to buy foods? Obviously, fresh is better. We all know that, but it's not always convenient or available. Is there an order like fresh, then frozen, dried, and then canned? Or what would be the order we would look for something if we have the options to buy them?
Yes, of course. Well, first option would be, my friends, if we're able to buy, and when it comes to like produce and that, if we can buy from our local farmers or growers, there are lots of markets out there. Well, that's great because it's local. You know, we know that there's not a lot of transportation going on. So we know it's fresh, but it's local too, right? So transportation also, the more we're transporting things, well, nutrients diminish. If not, we're speaking about fresh. If we can buy things organic, fantastic, because there's so much pesticides, et cetera, out there. I can even send Christine a whole list of the ones that are preferable to be organic and others that are not so essential. Frozen is another great option if it's available to us, because frozen basically is fresh and they freeze it. They don't add sodium, they don't add sugar, they don't add anything, right? I'm speaking about just one thing, like a berry or a pineapple, right? I'm not speaking about frozen meals, right? And then, well, when you're speaking about dry, is another great option. If you're speaking about dried mushrooms or the dried herbs, you know what I have discovered recently by speaking to some chefs, and so I might as well say, you know, with all these spices that all of us have, some kind of a spice rack, and we've got some spices. Did you all know, my friends, that there is in the bottom or somewhere, it tells you until the date. There's a date to the spices. So many times, like to me, they like given me gifts of spices and that, and then when I look at the date, they've expired. So it seems like our local chefs, there's a place here in Phoenix for restaurants, obviously like a warehouse or something, distributor, and they have like the freshest spices, herbs, etc. And last, as you said, what's the least last option would be the can, which we all have some, you know, something canned. Maybe we have, right, I have here also some can of tuna. I also have a plant-based tuna. So that's not tuna, you know, it's just a soy base. So cans, so because the cans, you know, already have more contaminants, et cetera, if you can buy organic, fantastic. And if you can, like I mentioned, strain and get rid of part of the sodium, they say between 50 and sometimes 60% of the sodium, well, that's a practical option, right? What I always say is try to stay away from all these ready meals or frozen meals or processed things like, you know, the pizzas and all that. Try to see if you can buy your own ingredients and, you know, make things simple but more homemade so you really know what's out there, right? What you're consuming too. And also you'll have a better idea to know, you know, what makes you feel better, or if you're having some kind of digestive issues or, you know, concerns, you might realize what ingredient or what food it's, you know, you need to maybe decrease or just, you know, get rid of and do a trial and error for a week or two.
Great, thank you. We only have about 5 minutes left, so if anybody has any questions, Debbie, if you have any final thoughts you want to talk about.
Yeah, Christina. So the last little recipe and the final thought was, look, this is my homemade granola here, my friends. And Christina sent you the recipe. Basically, I just wanted to share with you how simple it is to make your own cereal at home. You just grab a bowl, or if you have several of you, you can all have a fun time. This one's made with oats, so it's, you know, rolled oats. You preheat the oven. You can add some like seeds. These are pumpkin seeds. You can add chia seeds. You can add nuts. I've got here my chia seeds. You can add some of the dried fruits that I mentioned. And also you can add some sweetener, whether it's maple syrup, honey, agave. And for your oil, you can use something like a coconut oil. You just mix it all together, put it in a tray there with some aluminum. And in the oven, depends, I think I wrote down according to 350 or so, so, you know, 40 minutes or so. And then you've got your granola here. Let's see. And the nice thing is, so you can grab, you know, a glass container and just have your granola just ready for any time, whether it's a breakfast or a snack. So I think that's about it, Christina. We've got the recipes, we've shared them, and if there's other things, of course, glad to answer.
Perfect. One final question. What are your thoughts on a plant-based substitute butter? How does it work well with recipes, taste-wise, all of that?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, again, it all depends. There's so many brands out there, so it would be a question of, that's not a bad idea, of course. If you're going plant-based or trying to add more, you'll just have to kind of experiment with the different brands out there. I always tell people the great thing to do is go online, look at the reviews, kind of Google, you know, this brand or the other brand. And so, you know, people are there always commenting on what works more, what works, you know, less, and then give it a try, of course. Great option.
Wonderful. Well, Debbie, thank you so much again for today. We have learned so much. Sorry this isn't in person, because it would have been nice to have a nice little treat. I'm sure everybody agrees who's been watching. We would have all liked a little biteful. So thank you so much. For all of those who have attended, we have taped today's session, so it should be available in a few weeks on our website, www.baroneuro.com/MAPC shortly, and I'll send that link out along with, like I said, our virtual resource fair this afternoon, so you all should have that. So thank you very much. And everybody have a wonderful rest of your day. Bye, Debbie.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye, everyone. Keep safe.